What's up, guys? It is Corey from Super Kami Guru 9000, and today we are going to review the brand new Naruto Shippuden movie, which was just released on DVD in Japan. That's right, it is Road to Ninja, and this is one of the coolest Naruto movies I've ever seen, and it's probably one of the most different ones I've ever seen, and that's because it breaks away from some of the established formulas that we've seen in the other Naruto movies, which is pretty typical, just Naruto meeting someone who's similar to them, they solve a problem, that's the end of the day. There is a problem that needs to be solved in this movie, however, it is something a little different. Now, if you guys remember, about a year ago I reviewed an episode of Naruto Shippuden, which we will put a link to in the description box below, and in the box below you'll be able to see that. It's an episode where we get to see the Bizarro version of Konoha. In specifics, we get to see Sakura. She's from this other weird universe, and she gets to visit the people in Konoha. And we've always wondered, why is that? What's going on? Well, apparently that was a tie-in episode for this brand new movie. And what's cool about this movie is it actually uses all of the main characters in the series. They actually don't introduce, like, any real new villains for this movie. There is one that's kind of new, but in a sense he's kind of similar, and I'll explain a little bit later. But first and foremost, the story has to deal with Madara. He has his plans for the Moon Eye plan. We've all known about this. And he's going to test it out with this brand new form. It's like a weakened version of the Eye of the Moon plan. And the movie actually opens up with the Akatsuki finally showing up on Konoha. And what's strange is they've all been defeated. And essentially this whole scene is just an excuse to have our characters fight against them. And, you know, at first when I was watching the scene, I was like, okay, none of them are talking, none of them have any real personality, and, you know, they aren't really doing much, but hell, everything looks really fucking awesome. All the fight scenes are cool, you get to see Tenten fight against Hidan. I think that's worth the ticket price alone. But it moves on a little bit later, we do get to find out that they are actually Zetsu clones, but this was all a big distraction, because Tobi was trying to gather a little bit of information, and then eventually we get to see Sakura and Naruto are sulking a little bit, and they run into Tobi. And that's when he activates this crazy plan where he hits him with this genjutsu ability, and he's able to trap them in this sort of weird pseudo-bizarro world where all of the characters' characteristics are completely opposite of what they usually are. And at first when I learned this, I was like, oh, that's going to be pretty much the entire shtick of the entire movie, isn't it? Hey, you know how this character is like this? Guess what? Now they're like this! And luckily they didn't really focus on that too much. They did sort of joke about it a little bit at first when Naruto and Sakura are introduced to this bizarre world, and there's some pretty obvious ones. For example, you have Kiba from the Inuzuka clan, who's all about the dogs in the original Naruto universe. What's the opposite of dogs? It's cats. He's obsessed with cats in this one, and I'm not gonna lie, it is pretty funny seeing him react that way. And there are some other characters that have some extremes, and there are some that really aren't that extreme, like Shino, for example. He still has the same characteristics of wanting to be noticed by people and not really liking it when they forget his existence altogether. But instead of liking bugs, he hates bugs in this one. So it pretty much ends kind of right there. But there are some other extremes, like there's Hinata. Of course, in the original series, she's very soft-spoken, you know, very unsure of herself. In this one, she is hardcore balls to the wall. Not only does she dress a lot more suggestively, but she's a lot more protective of Naruto, who in this world goes by the name of Menma. And there's a few scenes where she actually gets pretty heated with Sakura, actually threatening to kill her if she goes anywhere near Menma, and it's definitely pretty funny. But when the movie really gets interesting, however, when we get to see that our characters are starting to get kind of comfortable with this world. And at first it's Sakura, and in the original world, this is actually when we're actually introduced to her parents for the very first time, which is pretty interesting, we've never seen them before. And in the actual Naruto world, she actually doesn't like the fact that they're always meddling in with her life and just sort of trying to take control of everything, and she doesn't really appreciate the fact that she has loving parents. And in this brand new world, her father apparently was one of the Hokages and one was like a hero of the village, so everybody loves Sakura. The problem is her parents are now gone and she's an orphan, but she's sort of taking advantage of this. She likes being able to hang around her house, do whatever she wants, eat her favorite foods, what have you. Naruto, on the other hand, is like, screw this noise, I don't like this, none of this is real, it makes no sense. However, the tables seem to turn a little bit when he finally is introduced to his parents, and the scene is, you know, kind of, I don't know, I wouldn't say it's heartwarming so much as it's kind of disturbing in a sense, too. And I kind of like what they were going for. At first, they kind of made it seem like the parents really, really cared about Naruto, and they do, they really do, they see him as his son. But Naruto just can't accept this, and you can't really blame him because none of this is real. It's all a false reality to him, and he just will not accept any of it. He won't accept their kindness, their love, even the food that they want to give him. And eventually he gets to that point where he does start to break down a little bit, and he starts to realize, maybe this isn't as bad as, you know, I really think it is. Maybe we can make a lot out of this situation. And it's at this point where we finally get to see that Sakura is starting to turn over a new leaf as well, and she starts to realize, maybe it's not good if I get to eat my favorite foods all the time. Maybe I need my parents here. And to make matters worse, she runs up on Sasuke, and yes, Sasuke does appear in this, and he is a Genjutsu person, and his his personality is really funny. You know, essentially he's a cold fish in the actual Naruto universe. He really doesn't give a crap about anything that has to do with the female form. And in this movie, he's a total player. He gives roses to, like, every single girl he runs into, and he acts like they're the most important thing in the world. And they continue to lap it up, and it's hilarious. And it makes sense that it would be Sasuke that would snap Sakura out of this situation. However, when she meets Naruto again, she realizes that he's becoming way too comfortable with this entire situation. And that's really where the main focus of the movie is. There is a little bit more action towards the end when we are introduced to the main villain of this movie, which, spoiler alert, is actually the evil version of Naruto from this alternate universe who goes by the name of Menma. And he does have some different aesthetics to him. He has black-colored hair. He wears this really elaborate cloak and this, like, Anbu-looking mask, which does look pretty cool. And he is still the Jinchuriki of the Nine Tails. And basically what happens is he meets up with Tobi, who's able to exist within both universes. And Tobi helps him collect all the Jinchuriki and helps him become really powerful. And ultimately, it results with Naruto figuring out, okay, maybe this world isn't exactly what I thought it was at first, but it's not exactly bad either. But we still need to get home, so it ends up having this huge battle with Menma and all of his freaky, like, pseudo-like Akatsuki members, which essentially are these group of weird characters wearing the same masks as him. He even has a group, he has this guy in his group who's literally like a tiger wearing a mask. It's really crazy. If you're able to just accept what's going on, it's pretty cool, because the final battle is pretty exciting. Because we actually get to see this universe's version of the Akatsuki, and in this universe, they're a group of good mercenaries. However, they still have most of their personalities intact. What is cool is we get to see them fight against all of these different characters in this very explosive scene. You get Naruto, who's wearing the fourth Hokage's jacket. You know, just it's all pure fan service, and all the action looks really good, but it is sort of overshadowed by the fact that the story itself, I actually think, is really good. So, do I think that this is the very best Naruto Shippuden movie? Right now, I actually want to say yes, if only for the fact that this proves that the characters are interesting enough to carry a story on their own. You know, a lot of the times with these shonen battle manga series, it's always about the action this, action that, Rasengan beam, Gummo Gummo this. But really, this one shows that you can care about these characters a lot and the things that they go through. You can feel for Naruto. And there's just a lot of really well-done, heartwarming scenes in this movie. And I never expected to actually like that. I was going into this expecting to see a ton of action and seeing all of the, Akatsuki guys fighting everybody. And that's actually a very small fraction of this film. But it doesn't take away from it. It actually enhances the movie. And when the action does happen, it blows you away. It looks cool. What I can say is the animation is kind of plain. It really is no more than a really high-quality episode. I mean, the fight scenes with the Akatsuki and the stuff towards the end is definitely a little more leaning towards movie quality. But for the most part, it's just a really nice looking episode. But I still think it's worth checking out, if only for the emotional moments. And just to see Naruto interacting with his parents, just to see what that would be like. It's, like I said, it's heartwarming and kind of disturbing at the very same time. So, guys, that's pretty much the end of this one. I think you guys should definitely check this movie out, though. It's definitely worth a watch. If I were to give this movie a score out of 10, I'd probably give it an 8. It's not perfect. Like I said, some of the animation is, you know, nothing to be desired. You know, it could have been a little bit better. And there were a few moments towards the beginning of the movie where they do fall into that stereotype of, here's the opposite version of this character, but it doesn't stay there for too long. It's still a worthy successor for the Naruto films, and I really have to applaud it for being original and something different. So, that's the end of this one, guys. If you guys didn't enjoy the movie or if you didn't like it, I'd love to know what you thought. You can let me know in your comments below. Remember, guys, as always, if you like this video, make sure and give it a thumbs up. It really helps them out a lot. That concludes this review today. Super Kamiguru 9000, out.